night, to everyone's surprise, we find out that it wasn't just Americans in Normandy. Indeed, it wasn't just Americans fighting the Germans in World War II. Sometimes I look back at the events in Normandy in last June for the 70th anniversary, and all we heard about was the Americans, the Americans, the Americans, the Americans. And I remember seeing that smiling face of Vladimir Putin there, and hardly any mention of the Russians' participation in World War II. And I'm sure maybe on Gold Sword and Juno there was mention of the British and the Canadians, but I didn't see much around Omaha Beach and Utah Beach. And their participation was huge. And so tonight, that's what the topic of our presentation is, the British beaches, the Canadian beach, and their activities in Normandy up to about the end of August. So our speaker tonight is John Rickard. He's from Kingston, Ontario. He's a captain in the Canadian Army. He's a recent graduate of the Canadian Army Command and Staff College. He currently works as developing the professional education for the Canadian Officer Corps. He's written numerous books. Some of them have been the topic of previous roundtable presentations. Advance and Destroy, Patton as a Commander in the Bulge, and Patton at Bay on the Lorraine Campaign. He's currently editing the wartime journals of Robert S. Allen, who was the Deputy Intelligence Officer for Patton's Third Army. I know he's going to do a great job, and it's an important topic, and it's one that we often ignore too much. And so please welcome John Rickard.
Captains need colonels to sort them out. Before I start, I'd just like to start off with a little bit of humor. For all of you here who are concerned about your health as you go on in age, I'd like for you to consider Churchill's encounter with General Montgomery on the beaches of England in anticipation of a German invasion. And the Prime Minister came across the general inspecting the fortifications and said, General Montgomery, let's head off to the mess and have a drink. And Montgomery said, Prime Minister, I neither drink nor smoke, and I'm 100% fit. Well, you never would win a verbal argument with Churchill. And he took a long draw off his cigar, and he looked at him, and he said, General Montgomery, I both drink and smoke, and I'm 200% fit. That's one of my favorite Churchill instances of humor. That's Field Marshal Montgomery on the right and his second Army Commander, General Sir Miles Christopher Dempsey on the left. Those two were the key architects of the Anglo-Canadian strategy on the eastern flank in Normandy. And clearly this is focused on the Anglo-Canadians tonight, but I'm sure you will all keep in mind that as this massive engagement is going on in the eastern flank, the American First Army is fighting all out to advance west, north, and south at the same time that the Anglo-Canadians are fighting hard around the Caen lodgement area. It's very, very important that everyone understand fundamentally the concerns that Montgomery had before the invasion started, and exactly what his mentality was as we crossed the channel and started to engage the Germans. And based on his experience in North Africa, in Tunisia, in Italy, he developed his operational technique along these lines. The top set are the fundamental basis of his set-piece battle approach. And when I say set-piece battle, I mean deliberate planning with a deliberate objective for a deliberate span of time. Identify a German position to attack, marshal overwhelming force, attack it, destroy it, and hopefully hold it. Because the overriding doctrinal technique that the Germans used over and over again was an immediate counterattack, and they became almost slavishly bound by it. And we took advantage of it, actually, all of us, not only the Americans, but the British and the Canadians as well. The tooth there are probably the most important thing, and they're linked. Monty fundamentally believed that the maintenance of morale was the key thing that had to be sustained for the war to be successful in terms of the British Army. The British had been fighting all out since 1939. Actually, in 1940, they get kicked out of France, they get kicked out of Norway, they get kicked out of Greece, and they get driven back in North Africa until Monty starts to turn the tide at El Alamein in late 1942. And that's their first real major victory. From that point forward, he's heavily criticized for being overly cautious, but the key thing in his mind is that the army, the nation, can have no more defeats. They lost the hood. Bismarck sunk the hood. They lost Singapore. Tobruk surrendered. So just please keep that in mind. I know there's a great tendency to criticize the field marshal for being slow in comparison to Patton or Joe Collins or some of the other very highly aggressive American commanders. But everything has a context and everything has a reason. And the reason for Montgomery's approach is fundamentally psychological. It's the maintenance of morale, and he wants to maintain morale by keeping casualties low. Now, I won't speak to this slide too much, but I just want you to keep in mind this blue line here, which is the D plus 90 line, where we plan to be 90 days after we invaded. And that's the Seine River, and that's Paris. And I'll come back to that later on when we talk about the overall effectiveness of Montgomery's strategy for Normandy. All right, these are the three beaches, Gold, Juno, and Sword. As you can see, the Canadians are in the middle. What I want you to pay attention to here is the fact that, between Juno and Sword, there's a gap of about 5 miles. And it's very important to consider the fact that the British 3rd Infantry Division, which is over here, came ashore and landed in a different way than the Canadians on the right and the 6th Airborne Division on the left. 3rd British Division landed in column of brigades. So one brigade landed, and one brigade was supposed to pass through and capture Caen. And I'll come back to that in a minute. I'm sure you're all aware of the story of the 6th Airborne Division, which captures what will become Pegasus Bridge and bridges over the Orne Canal. Other elements of British 6th Airborne will go up and capture the Merville Battery. This is the Merville Battery here. Pegasus Bridge is down here. This bridgehead area here was absolutely essential to be taken and held because the possibility of a major counterattack by the elements of 15th Army, which are primarily focused in the Pas-de-Calais to the northeast, was real. And it was a serious threat that gave the commanders many, many sleepless nights. These are the actual photographs of the gliders as they land, and that's the actual bridge right there. And by coup de main, they take the bridge and hold it. That's a picture of Pegasus Bridge that I took back in 1995. Has anyone been to Pegasus Bridge? So you all know the story. I can just stop and sit down now. I'll just. This is Merville Battery. There are four casemates. This was critical in the planning to take and destroy this battery because the range of the guns could hit Sword Beach, where 3rd British Division was coming ashore. The intelligence before the war suggested that these were 105-millimeter guns, but the 6th Airborne Division report after the war, or at the time, actually written at the time, said they were only 75-millimeter guns. Still, 75-millimeter guns could reach Sword Beach. Now, I know this is a busy slide, but at the end of the day, the Canadians are roughly over here. 3rd British Division came ashore in this area here. And down here is Lebesee Wood. And this is Caen down here, and this is the Orne River. When the British came ashore, 8th Brigade established the beachhead, and 185th Brigade came through, and they were blocked heavily by the Hillman Fort and by Lebesee Wood. And they effectively do not get to Caen on D-Day. It may have been better or been more effective had the Corps commander, General Sir John Crocker, commander of 1st British Corps, decided not to move the reserve brigade, the 9th British Brigade, over to the 6th Airborne Bridgehead to reinforce it because of pressure coming from the east. Diverting that brigade essentially meant that you had one British brigade attempting to take Caen on D-Day. Even that may not have been so bad had it not been for the fact that there's a 5-mile gap between the British on the left and the Canadians on the right, simply by the way the British came ashore. We came ashore 2 brigades up and 1 brigade in reserve. We came ashore on Juno Beach. And this is what our beach area looks like. These lines here are actually our phase lines, which are also our objective lines, initial, intermediate, and final objective. Now, right down here is Carpiquet, and the airfield's just down here off the slide. That's our final D-Day objective for 9th Canadian Infantry Brigade. However, as you can see, the Germans, Kampfgruppe Rauch, which is part of 21st Panzer Division, actually manages to make its way all the way to the coast at Lyon-sur-Mer, and for a brief moment in time splits the British from the Canadians at that point. Can everyone see that fairly clearly? You can be truthful. This is the situation at last light on 6 June. This is our objective down here, and this is where we are. The 7th Canadian Infantry Brigade goes into a brigade fortress, and the 8th Brigade goes into its brigade fortress, and 9th Brigade has passed through and come forward and stops at dark. And this has always been a point of contention with me, because in this critical phase of the operation, Montgomery had always said that you have to penetrate deeply without any regard to your flanks. So the key is to drive deep and engage the Germans as far south as possible and not worry so much about your flanks. Monty said we can deal with that later. But he wants to come forward as far south as he can to especially anticipate and meet and block German counterattacks, particularly panzer counterattacks. Unfortunately for us, the possibility of actually getting to Caen on D-Day was pretty slim, not simply because we were sluggish in movement at night, essentially waiting to sunrise before we moved again, but because 21st Panzer, elements of 21st Panzer are all over the place, well forward northwest of Caen. This is actually on D-Day, and that's our objective. The fact of the matter is it was bad enough that we had to fight through elements of 21st Panzer to get down to our D-Day objective. But by the next day, June 7th, D plus one, by about 1,400 hours, about 1,400 hours, we actually are face-to-face with the 25th SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment, which is the lead regiment of the 12th SS Panzer Division. And they moved quick and moved fast, and before we knew it, we were engaged with Panzer Grenadiers and tanks. That engagement effectively blocks us from getting to our objective. It's about 7 or 8 miles from this point. And from our position up here down to Carpaquet is about 9 miles. Before the war, as the planning's going on, very quickly realized that the Canadians are given essentially one of the most difficult assignments, because we are on, come ashore on the best ground that we identified for a breakout and the best ground the Germans identified for a counterattack. So as you can see, these red symbols are the Panzer divisions. 12th SS, one at 21st Panzer, SS up here in 15th Army. This is Panzer Lehr here. So you can do the math, and we're not talking about a very big area. It looks big on the map, but it's really not, and a forced march for the three closest Panzer divisions put them all in the beachhead area within D plus one or D plus two. It's this fact that leads the planners to augment 3rd Canadian Infantry Division. It's about 18,500 men. The standard divisional artillery is 72 guns, but for the invasion, the guns are doubled, plus augmented by the artillery of commando elements from the British. So the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division actually directly controls about 200 guns when it comes ashore on D-Day. But on D plus one, when we engage the 12th SS, our vanguard, our lead element, all the FOOs, everyone knows what a FOO is, forward observation officer for the artillery, they all get killed, and the comms with the artillery goes down. And we end up fighting the SS for 24 hours without any artillery support at all. And we can't even get back. We have no comms with the naval gunfire offshore. So it, and of course the Germans don't have any air support. So it's a straight fight between the 18-year-old SS soldiers and the soldiers from all across Canada in the 3rd Division. I put this map up here because it shows the basic layout of the German divisions on D-Day and where they are, the red or the Panzer divisions. But I just want to talk about this area here and where Caen is, because there's a tendency to make the argument that the British should have broken out on the eastern flank penetrate it far, much deeper south, or expand the bridgehead to the east. Well, going east is really a non-issue because the 15th Army's there. Going south, obviously, was part of the plan. How far south exactly continues to be debated. But keep in mind that at various points in the Normandy campaign, we are going in all four cardinal directions. We're going to the east to reinforce the bridgehead across the Orne River. We're attacking south to take Caen. The Americans are trying to link up all their beaches. They have to go west, and then they have to go north to Cherbourg as they try to go south to expand the lodgement area. It's that sort of complexity that we have to keep in mind as an Allied team. because in the initial stages of the operation, we're all being pulled in different directions for different localized objectives. This just shows you the general scale, the distance. Panzer Lehr's down here, for example, it's 82 miles away on D-Day when we come ashore northwest of Caen. 12th SS is in this general area here. And by night moves, they come in across the bridge across the Orne River and counterattack us in this area here at about 1,400 hours on D plus 1. 1st SS Panzer Division is up in Brussels. And these are the headquarters of the High Command on the Seine River. This is the 2nd British Army estimate of what we would face on D-Day. 21st Panzer was estimated to already be in the area. 12 SS could intervene within hours. And by D plus 3, they expected Panzer Lehr to come up and be engaged. All the while, there's an airborne division, an infantry division, and an infantry division in this area here. We are trying to land the armored brigades as fast as we can. As we'll see a little bit later on, the weather becomes a factor in how fast we can match the German buildup, because it's a race. It is the amazing race. It's how fast we can build up from England versus how fast the Germans can build up and concentrate against us to try to rope us off and block us so we can't break out like Anzio and like Salerno. This is a sketch that is found in the Rommel papers that Rommel developed himself. This is the optimal situation where the Germans would be able to replace all their panzer divisions with infantry divisions, pull all the panzer divisions back, and then launch a massive panzer counterattack to the coast to split the British from the Americans. As you can see, 21st Panzer's there, 1st SS, 12th SS, between Bayeux and Caen. And this is the optimal area. 50th British Division is there, Canadians are here, British Division in the Orne Bridgehead. That was the great fear. And once the Panzer Divisions show up piecemeal, because they can get there the fastest, because they're the most motorized and the most mobile, it became essential that we actually grab them by the belt and don't let them withdraw. And that becomes Monty's overriding principle for fighting the campaign. Do not let the Panzer Divisions disengage. Because if they disengage, now they have flexibility to concentrate and try to launch a mass attack against some sector of the front. This is the Canadian front on 7-8 June. This is the 9th Brigade coming down toward Carpiquet, and this is the 25th SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment, which counterattacks. It's possible that they ambushed us. It becomes a running fight, and we retreat back to the La Boussin, Caron-Buron area and go into a brigade fortress. That brigade fortress, along with the other brigade fortresses by the other Canadian brigades, effectively halts the Germans along this line here. But we don't get south of the Caen Bayou Road or the railroad, and we don't get to Carpiquet. And it'll take us until July 8th to take that place. I think personally that it was too deep an objective. There were a lot of expectations on D-Day, and the planning, the planners, I think, were a little bit too ambitious about what, how far the troops could penetrate in a single day, given the likely response intervention by Panzer divisions, not simply infantry divisions, but Panzer divisions. It's the German counterattack. On the command side, this is the commander of our division, General Roderick Keller, who had no previous combat experience. We have a very difficult time for political reasons. We preached in the Canadian Army before D-Day that we needed battle experienced commanders for the operation. And when D-Day came, we had no battle experienced commanders. For political reasons, we sent a corps to Italy, an infantry division, an armored division. And that skill, that knowledge, was never brought back to lead the invasion. Now, it's hit and miss about the effectiveness of the veteran divisions. If you study the British Army very carefully, Monty was convinced that bringing back the Desert Rats and bringing back 51st Highland Division and 50th Division, those veteran divisions from North Africa and Italy, would be the foundation upon which the Second Army fought. But when you study them carefully, it's very clear that they were very close to being worn out, having been fighting the Desert Rats have been fighting since 1940. And then they go home to England, see their families, and they get new orders. Right, you're going to be in spearhead of the invasion, or the second wave. Thanks very much. I think there was a level of fatigue in the British Army that Monty knew, beyond a shadow of a doubt, and that he tried to deal with as best he could. But in terms of getting it right about the ability of the veteran divisions to fight effectively, he gets it wrong, I think, in that case. Keller, for example, is heavily criticized by the British commander Crocker for not properly coordinating his artillery and his three brigades and his tanks on D plus one. Blames him for the setback against the SS. And this will follow him throughout the course of the campaign. And he's on the verge of being relieved when the bombers accidentally wound him in early August during one of the big operations south of Caen. It's not just him. The Canadian commander of the 2nd Division has no combat experience. The commander of the 4th Canadian Armored Division, who comes ashore a month later, is an infantry soldier that's given command of the Armored Division with no command, no divisional command experience. I don't have time to go into all the details about why that's so, but it was a serious problem that the Army recognized and at the end of the day just dropped the ball on. The Army in conjunction with the government. Politics, we all know what politics can do to best plans. So that's the situation on the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division front on 11 June. You can see we're still not at Carpiquet. And the British are well south of Bayeux. Bayeux falls very, very quickly. On D-Day and D plus one, effectively neutralized. But Caen hangs on. And I'll just say this about Caen. Looked at the plans and the scheme of maneuver on the ground, it's my opinion that Montgomery really did not plan on taking Caen frontally on D plus one, or D-Day, or D plus one. I think it's in his orders to satisfy the airmen who are obsessed with airfields south of Caen, and I don't think Monty gave a rat's you know what about airfields south of Caen in the early stages of the campaign. This is what Montgomery says in his directives to Bradley and Dempsey on D plus two. As you can see, I've decided not to have a lot of casualties by butting up against the place. So he's going to try to outflank it and then move southeast. That's just a picture of the SS. I'm sure you've all seen pictures of the SS. Formidable opponents. I'll just say, I know everyone loves the movie Saving Private Ryan, and so do I. But that scene where Caparzo, I think it is, comes up with a Hitler Youth knife out of the trench on the beach, that's fiction. That's Hollywood fiction. 12th SS are against us to the east. the Americans don't face SS troops until the 17th SS Panzergrenadier Division comes up several days later. But still a great movie. Hollywood. This is Kit Donnie. He's one of Montgomery's aide-de-camps. This is what he said at the time. And you'll see a consistent theme. Montgomery, of course, does himself no service by declaring after the war that everything went just according perfectly to plan. everyone's jumped on him for that since. But in general terms, his concept was to pivot en camp, force the Germans to commit the bulk of their panzer divisions there, hold them there, so that the First Army on the right could more easily break out. Because of all the panzer divisions against First Army, they weren't going to break out. And there's no point in the Anglo-Canadians running or going east or going west if the Americans aren't ready yet. Because the Americans, the First Army, has to swing through a giant arc to come along in line with us. So we are the pivot simply by geographical nature of the campaign. So clearly Monty doesn't want to take on Caen frontally at this time. This is 10 June, and this is his plan to outflank Caen. The Desert Rats will attack in that direction. 51st Highland Division will attack to the east. Airborne troops will be landed just across the Odon River, which is right here. And then airborne troops again will be dropped to link up the two main concentrations. Now, this is not the first time he's planned to use airborne troops to link up, to basically drop airborne troops in the middle of nowhere to link up large formations. And everyone's aware of Market Garden and how deep that was. But these divisions, 1st Airborne Division, would have been landed right in the teeth of the SS Panzer Divisions. So I think he's justifiably criticized for this, but this was a legitimate plan. This was on the books and ready to go. But the commander of the Allied Expeditionary Air Force, Lee Mallory, absolutely refused to execute the operation to drop the paratroopers. Lee Mallory also was heavily against dropping 82nd and 101st. He thought it was going to be an absolute massacre. This plan collapses because on 10-12 June, the Germans launch a very large counterattack with elements of 12th SS against the airborne bridgehead across the Orne River. Shuts down the entire operation because forces get diverted. So Monty doesn't give up on the west flank. He's still avoiding Caen, and he decides to go after Villers-Bocage, which is right there. Primarily spearheaded by the Desert Rats. This is 11, 12, 13 June. This is an absolute unmitigated disaster for the Desert Rats. They're already a bit hesitant about fighting in the Bocage country. This isn't the desert, and they have a hard time making the adjustment. But Whitman, Michael Whitman, number 2 Company, 501st Heavy Tank Battalion, essentially by himself in the initial stages, cripples the entire British 22nd Armored Brigade, the spearhead of the division, destroying over 100 vehicles with his own Tiger. He goes back and refuels, comes forward again with 4 more Tigers, and essentially annihilates the brigade. All by himself, that one small unit cripples a major British offensive, which has repercussions. Division commander gets relieved. Monty starts to question the effectiveness of those veteran divisions you brought back. I don't have to have time to go into all the command problems, but if I could show you a master list of all the people that get relieved in Normandy on the Canadian and British side, you would very quickly appreciate how ferocious the fighting is and how short the leash is on command performance. So you're not getting a lot of time to actually learn your craft. Essentially one or two and you're done. Errors or big mistakes. This is 18 June. This is key for him. So we haven't taken comm, but you know what? The enemy has never had the initiative. And then he decides to continue to push the pincer movement from both flanks. The next day, and this is how frustrating planning can be, because the plan in the commander's mind, once it goes down to the staff or deep detail planning, can be ruined very quickly when the reality sets in. And that's what he says about the problem of getting 8 Corps across the into the eastern bridgehead where the 6th Airborne Division is. And of course, that same day, there's a giant storm in the channel, which effectively ruins the British Mulberries, the artificial concrete docks where the shipping lands and the troops are unloaded. Because Monty is trying to get more combat power into the bridgehead area, and because of the storm, he has to delay bringing in new infantry divisions, new armored divisions, and separate armored brigades. And he's very, very worried about it because that storm doesn't affect the German reinforcement rate. So in that little window, the Germans take advantage of it, and intelligence indicates that they're starting to catch up and match our buildup rate, which is the worst possible thing that could happen for us. I know this map's busy too, but this is the Odon River. And that's Carpiquet, our D-Day objective. And this is the Orne River here. So this wedge here is very, very important, critical ground. This is the famous Hill 12 right here. This is Operation Epsom from 26 to 30 June. Trying to establish a bridgehead across the Odon River. The British are actually very successful. They get across and they penetrate deep. The problem is the 2nd SS Panzer Corps from the Russian front has finally arrived and they counterattack from three different directions. So as we can see here, the 11th Armored Division captures Hill 112. And then, because of the threat of the 2nd SS Panzer Corps, the Corps commander orders them to withdraw. They voluntarily give up Hill 112. And what do the Germans do? Well, they occupy Hill 112, the best piece of high ground west of the Orne River. You can see the casualties for Operation Epsom for the British, 4,020. And keep this in mind, 21st Army Group, about 18% of the Army Group is actually infantry. Armor is another small proportion. Overwhelming proportion of the Army Group are service personnel. That teeth-to-tail ratio is very, very big. So 4,000 casualties are virtually all in the infantry. The infantry in Normandy sustained about 76% of the total casualties. So when you lose that, you're losing about 3,000 of those are infantry in a period of 4 days. And that's just a picture of Hill 112, which becomes a vicious violence. Ongoing battle, back and forth, a seesaw battle to capture or hold 112. So I would encourage you all, if you get a chance, go do some independent study on 112 because it will fascinate you and capture your imagination as you study the back and forth nature of that engagement. So by 30 June, according to Montgomery, as he says, my broad policy, and when he says broad policy, he means my master plan. That's what he's really trying to say, that everything's going just according to the way I scripted it out before D-Day. And has always been to draw the main enemy forces to the battle on the eastern flank so that our affairs on the western flank, meaning our American allies, can proceed the easier. So on 30 June, these are the panzer divisions facing the Anglo-Canadians. So we're facing the bulk of the German panzer force at this stage. Monty finally realizes that these pincer movements and left flanking and right flanking simply aren't working. He's also under tremendous pressure from Eisenhower, who in Ike's friendly way keeps pushing him to move faster and let's get this going and take Caen. Operation Charnwood on 8 and 9 July is preceded by a massive bombing, heavy bombers, 800 heavy bombers dropping 6,000 bombs in this area right here in the northern suburbs of Caen. Monty was convinced that this was this would be the one thing that put him over the hump. But operational research after indicated that the bombing had not destroyed any German positions, primarily because the Germans lightly manned their forward positions in this area and were all back in the city. They were ready to come across the bridges. The 3rd Canadian Infantry Division is up here, and we come down and finally take Carpiquet after a brutal struggle and make it down to the bridges across the Odon River at Bretteville-sur-Odon. That's the bombing of Caen. Very, very controversial. Killed a lot of civilians in Caen. Monty never thought really anything of it at the time, because operational necessity dictated. I will tell you that in my research on Patton, most people think Patton was, you know, old blood and guts, bloodthirsty, kill them all, let God sort them out. But he was actually very, very sensitive to bombing of cities. And he wasn't comfortable with fire bombings later on, the mass saturation bombings of the cities. I think that he probably felt it was unfair and wanted to destroy the German army in the field, man to man. I'll leave it to your judgment when you go through and study the history whether or not you think the bombings helped us or hindered us in certain ways in terms of rubbling the city. This did cause incredible rubbling in the northern suburbs, which made it very difficult for us to pass through our formations. There are 3,500 vehicles in the Canadian Infantry Division. Those all have to come across through the tiny little streets. Who's been to Caen? A few people. Well, they're not big, giant, broad roads. So by this stage, Montgomery has brought in 1st Canadian Army, and this is Harry Currer, our commander. This is General Guy Simmons, commander of 2nd Canadian Corps. And this is very telling, this picture, because Montgomery was the direct mentor for Simmons, and Currer was sort of on the outs, because Simmons didn't respect the military capability of Currer. And it was palpable. And it had repercussions down the road and for the actual operations. Montgomery didn't respect the military capability of Currer. So you can imagine the command environment. So Simmons is actually in charge for the first time during Operation Atlantic, which is a subcomponent of Montgomery's bigger Operation Goodwood. Who's heard of Goodwood? Well, it's an absolute meat grinder for the British with massive casualties, but it does have some positive results. As you can see here, the Canadians are in these locations, and our job is to attack southwest, clear the southern suburbs of Caen, and then move down in this general direction toward Verrières. Verrières Ridge is right here, which is an infamous site for the Canadians. The British are actually going to penetrate straight down in this direction, and Goodwood is unique because General Dempsey said, we simply don't have the infantry to keep hammering away at the Germans time and time again. We have an abundance of armor. Let's use the armor next time. So they form 8 corps with 3 armored divisions, the Desert Rats, the Guards Armored Division, and the 11th Armored Division. Unfortunately, the line of departure is only a few miles wide, so it's impossible to line up the divisions abreast. So they have to go in column. At the end of the day, the column, the traffic congestion is massive all north of Caen, across the river, down into the bridgehead area. And they actually, when they actually break out, about half of the armor doesn't even get engaged because the traffic congestion is massive. They do precede the operation with a massive bombing. The Germans, the British attack in this direction, and we go like this. We get down here to this point, and the 7th Armored Division is actually on this position, Verrières, and they pull back. They are pulled back by the British Corps commander, and we take our crack at this line here. Unfortunately for us, our tank infantry cooperation was very, very poor. We functioned under a doctrine of having the tanks in support rather than under command. And all the military men in here know exactly what the difference is. Under command means you can order them and they'll move when they're told to move. In support is a lot more fuzzy. At the end of the day, the Canadians go up this ridge with 2 infantry regiments, the Essex Scottish and the South Saskatchewan Regiment, and both essentially get counterattacked and overrun by SS Panzer Grenadiers and Panther tanks, essentially wrecking both regiments. However, Goodwood does have some positive benefit. The British simply don't retreat to their bridgehead line, but they establish positions well down here to the south. It's a massive effort. They lose about 36% of their tank strength committed. They seriously underestimated the anti-tank screen the Germans had established and the fact that the Germans had established positions in depth, at least 3 positions. And the anti-tanks, the 88s, and the Panthers decimated the British armor, which, as you all know, I'm sure, the tanks are much inferior to German Panthers and Tigers and simply can't destroy an 88, about half the range that the 88 can destroy them. Psychologically, you can imagine being a tanker at this time, either in the American Army or the Anglo-Canadian armies, knowing full well my tank can only kill a German tank at 1,000 yards, while their tanks can kill my tank at 2,000 yards. That's psychology 101. So that was our objective, and we got to it and got pushed off of it and couldn't hold it because the SS counterattacked. This is just after Goodwood. And this is one of the most frustrating things for us because many of our operations are characterized as holding attacks. And you can imagine trying to explain that to the troops. But that's not the way it gets explained to the troops. The troops are told we're trying to break through. And this is where some of the confusion comes in because historians will look and say, well, General Simmons said we were breaking through to Falaise. He's saying that, I think, for morale, ultimately, knowing full well that at a certain point, when we've sustained a certain level of casualties, we'll shut it down because we're simply trying to hold the German panzer divisions there. We're not trying to break out because we're not ready yet. Because this is July 21st, and the Americans are still 4 days away from launching Cobra, the giant breakout on the right flank. So this is July 24, 25, the dispositions. We are smack dab in the middle, and from this point, we don't move. We're in this corridor, and this is our ground. This is all the Canadian responsibility. This is the Conflans Highway, which, and we spend the next month and a half trying to get down here to Falaise. As you can see, we're facing the cream of the army, the 1st SS, 12th SS, 2nd Panzer Division, 9th SS Panzer, 116th Panzer, the Greyhound Division, 2nd SS Panzer. Everywhere we look, we're facing SS Panzer troops. Can everyone see that okay? It's a bit... This is calm. This is the Orne River. This is the Conflans Highway. This is Verrières, where we had just been kicked off 5 days previous. Montgomery sends the order down for the Canadians to take Verrières Ridge 5 days after we suffered a big defeat there. So we send 2nd Canadian Infantry Division down here to attack from St. Martin de Fontenay over here to Tilly-la-Campagne on this line here. And all I can say is that it becomes it is another disaster, and this time we lose the entire elite Black Watch regiment from Montreal who assault Verrières Ridge in line formation with no tanks. The tanks don't arrive on time, and they are effectively annihilated, 315 casualties in about 30 minutes. And we retreat from Verrières Ridge again. This is called Operation Spring. The frustrating thing about Spring is that Simmons is, we have the 2nd Canadian Infantry Division, the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division, an entire Canadian tank brigade, plus a British armored division, plus a British infantry division in reserve for this operation. But one of the great weaknesses of the Canadian Army was this tendency to assign too little combat power to an objective. So every village became a battalion objective. This battalion, you go take that village. And we know full well now that there's a division, a German division within striking range of Verrières. It happens too much to be anything but a significant trend. We have a hard time actually adjusting and changing our ways. Armies can be very, very conservative. We don't learn our lesson here until about 2 weeks later, when we truly understand what it means to concentrate combat power against the Germans. This is July 27th. This is 2 days after the Americans have broken through or penetrated the main defensive positions of Panzer Lehr on the western flank, preceded by a massive bombing, of course, which virtually annihilates Panzer Lehr Division. And Lightning Joe Collins' 7th Corps divisions pour through and start to fan out in St. Lo and south, southwest, south, and southeast. And we're only 4 days away from 3rd Army being activated, and of course, Patton being let loose on the south flank. Monty was very appreciative. He said, "This blow, Cobra, is the foundation of all our operations, and it is well and truly struck. But now the Anglo-Canadians need to keep up the pressure in the Caen area. 2nd British Army must hurl itself into the fight in the Caumont area." And Caumont is essentially on the boundary between the British and the Americans, pretty much in the center of the Normandy bridgehead area. All this to make it easier for the Americans to continue their swing to the southeast. Now keep in mind, when you do break out, you still have to go in multiple directions. You break out through Cobra and you still have to go west to the coast. You send forces all the way into the Brittany Peninsula. You're going due south and you're trying to come out east. To say that it's an impressive performance on the American side is an understatement, because once you broke clean, Patton moves at incredible speed. And he's clearly, the Germans are fragmented, but he makes that show happen. And I think if someone else was commanding 3rd Army at the time, they probably wouldn't close up with us around the Caen area as fast. So Cobra has happened, and Montgomery decides to launch Operation Bluecoat in this area here, southwest of Caen. And we're right here, the Canadians. This is designed to facilitate the American push. As you can see how far the Americans are going, right? The ultimate objective is over here. But they still have to clear out these, according to the pre-invasion plan, to clear out the Brittany ports, Saint-Malo and Lorient and Saint-Malo, Brest, which sends them in the opposite direction from where we ultimately are going to end up. And this is key here, Mortain. This is where the Germans will try to change the balance of the game in Normandy, an act of utter desperation on Hitler's part. This is the objective for 2nd British Army in Bluecoat, to establish blocking positions from Vire to just north of Mont Pichon, which is the highest point in Normandy. They're afraid that if the Germans, we can't push the Germans off that, they'll use it as a pivot so that they can swing back and delay and slow down this rush of Americans that are coming to the east. The British also want to establish a bridgehead across the Orne River at Thury Harcourt. This is to help us drive down the Conflans Road. This is to put pressure on the Germans to help force them to withdraw in front of us. And this is 4 August. And this is the instruction that we get, 2nd Canadian Corps gets. This is the mission. To break through the enemy positions as early as possible, but not later than 8th August. Every day counts. And this is General Simmons, and this is his problem as he sees it. And this is the key. Getting through the initial phase, German positions, is really pointless if we can't knock out their anti-tank gun screen, which is further in depth. Because they just annihilate armored formations at a very rapid pace and very quickly and efficiently. So this is the essential planning map that Simmons used to get down here to Falaise, in the direction of Falaise. And I'll just walk you through it very slowly. The Germans have a major defensive position in this location. Collins right here. Germans have another major prepared defensive position south, about 3 miles to the south. So we, the Canadians, have to break through the first one. Then we have to regroup. And then we have to break through the second position before we can even think about exploiting. The key for Simmons is the use of heavy bombers to annihilate this forward position at night. A night drop, so that by sunrise we can push through the disorganized German positions. This reorganization position here is a holding position while the bombers come back and destroy, try to annihilate the second defensive position. And then we'll push through and keep rolling. It looks wonderful on the map. This is the breakdown of the German positions immediately prior to Operation Totalize, which commences on 8 August. It's called Totalize for a reason. It's a total Canadian all-out effort, everything we have, every cook, bottle washer, every last round that's available. As you can see, the German infantry division's here. 272nd is over here. 89th has actually come up and replaced 12th SS Panzer Division. 12th SS Panzer Division elements are down here. The key to keep in mind at this point on 8 August is that Hitler has withdrawn the bulk of the Panzer Divisions away from us. They've gotten away from us to go to the west flank to launch Operation Lüttich, which is a massive panzer counterattack against the Avranches bridgehead area, the right flank of the American Army trying to break out. It's an all-or-nothing gamble. From my perspective, had they not done that, had Hitler not done that, the Germans had sufficient skill to absorb the 1st American Army advance east as long as they pivoted on Caen, and we couldn't destroy that pivot, and they could have absorbed the blows and withdrawn step by step if that's what they chose to do. But Hitler essentially put their head in the noose, took the Panzer divisions away from the key pivot, stuck them out there in the middle of nowhere, completely vulnerable to American air power and American mechanized formations. And once they were done, it was done. Replenishment with fuel and ammunition was very, very difficult. So this should have made our job a lot easier, because all the Panzer divisions, the bulk of them, are gone. In fact, the night bombing, which starts at 2300 hours on August 7th, is very effective and destroys the bulk of the German position, and we roll through. The key is having to stop and wait for the bombers to come back in daylight for the second bombing. And we essentially sit there for about 8 hours waiting. And if World War II teaches you anything, it's that if you give the Germans 8 hours, they can do pretty much anything. They can reorganize and create the most effective defensive positions out of virtually nothing. And that's what they did. We had a real problem getting through that second position. So this is what we actually did. We actually stopped down here, and this is where we're brought to a halt. And Falaise is down here. So we've made considerable progress. That's about 6 miles we've penetrated through the main German defensive positions. This kind of advance was unheard of earlier in the campaign because the density of the Panzer divisions was just overwhelming. This is actually the Caen-Falaise Road. You can see how it bends to the south. This is point 195 over here. And I'll just indicate this because this is where one of our armored regiments was supposed to go. But in the fog of war, you can imagine thousands of bombs dropping and the dust and the smoke, and at night we were firing Bofors down the axis with tracer rounds, trying to maintain the axis so we wouldn't go lose our way. But that failed. The armored regiment, instead of going this way, went this way, went down into the wood line and got ambushed by the Germans and essentially was annihilated. And we couldn't find them. And that's an example of the fog of war. So that's where we stopped and totalized. And then 6 days later, a week later, on August 14th, we launched Operation Tractable, where we launched the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division and the 4th Armored Division down to take an objective just north of Falaise. Okay. This is just a basic map showing you Caen and the hinge and the fillet's pocket and the incredible journey of the American Army once it breaks out in the south, going in all directions, trying to get down to the Loire River, and trying to get to the Seine. I think you can appreciate the incredible amount of maneuver that's going on. The Germans are maneuvering furiously to get out, across the bridges. The Americans are maneuvering furiously, short envelopment, and the envelopment gets deeper as the Germans gain success in getting out. That's a very busy map, but it essentially shows you the compression, the Canadians pushing hard southeast of Caen. And way over here, you've got the advance elements, the foremost elements of Third Army coming up to try to seal the penetration. And I'm sure you're all aware that the Germans do escape. We don't seal the pocket and capture all the Germans. Probably 50 or 60,000, difficult to assess, get out. Fortunately for them, a lot of their headquarters staff, their structures, get out so that they already exist. And that's why they so quickly reform in September 1944. They just add troops because the command and control structure is not destroyed yet for a lot of the corps and divisions. And that is just a very busy map showing the pursuit of the Germans beyond the Falaise Gap toward the Seine River with the British and the advance elements of Third Army. As you can see, the counterattack at Mortain was a desperate gamble. Had they not done that, how long would the Normandy campaign have gone on? Difficult to say. The Germans probably would have delayed the retreat to the Seine River by a couple weeks perhaps. But everything dependent on the British and the Canadians and the Americans getting lined up abreast. That's the most difficult part of the Normandy campaign is the geometry of it. The geometry was the most challenging part because we were going in all directions. And we all had to get lined up abreast to go east. But before we could do that, 1st U.S. Army on the west has to go through a whole bunch of gyrations. This is a basic list of the operations in sequence that we launch around Caen to attract the Germans and then penetrate the German forward positions to break their hinge around Caen. Because Caen is simultaneously Montgomery's hinge to assist 1st Army, and Caen is simultaneously the German hinge so that they can stretch to the west and fight. If they have no anchor in the east, it's suicide to fight in the west. And that's why Caen takes so long and such a battle of attrition over there, because both sides recognize the importance. And the ones in bold are the ones that the Canadians are in control of, responsible for. I talked about that planning map to begin with, and this is the Seine River, and this line here, this green line, is D plus 82. This is the date we actually get to the Seine bridges. The planning said we should have been there by D plus 90. So my point I'm trying to make is all this argument and confusion and some bitterness about what's going on here and how the campaign unfolded around Caen, to me, is ultimately irrelevant, because we get where we're supposed to be earlier than we're supposed to be there, according to the planners. That's the essential thing for me. Unfortunately, a lot of these, a lot of World War II history gets written from nationalist perspectives, but it really was a team effort. Granted, the Americans had the most divisions involved, and justifiably, Ike's in command of the whole show. Monty, of course, resents that because he's the, you know, he's the field marshal. He should be he should be commanding everything. But at the end of the day, sorry, we shouldn't lose sight of that fact that we get there where we're supposed to be ahead of schedule. And that's key. Now, I'll just walk you through. I'm almost finished. Have I put anybody to sleep yet? And be truthful. No. Okay, here are the initial landings. Four divisions. And the red are the Canadians. The attempts on Caen, outflanking attempts, various operations, that's Carpiquet. This is Epsom. It's Villers-Bocage. This is Charnwood. This is Goodwood. Windsor. Total Eyes. Bluecoat. Tractable. The British punch through, come up to Falaise. We take Falaise. The British expand on the east, and off we go. It took an awful lot to break the German pivot at Caen. Took a lot of casualties, it took a lot of time. Monty clearly doesn't do himself any justice when he says it goes exactly according to his brilliant plan. But I think you can see that at the end of the day, we all line up and get where we're supposed to be, which is the most important thing.
Is that Paris? You talk about Paris?
To the Seine River, yeah, Paris, yeah. Now, technology ate part of my map, my slide here. But here are the Canadian casualties in Normandy in 79 days of combat. 5,000 killed, we had 18,000 wounded, and the British had 11,000 killed, and if I do recall, the wounded are 37,000. And I'm sure some of you are wondering what I actually look like with a bit more hair. I know that's probably been on your mind. I wonder what that guy looks like. This is me in 1995 at Omaha Beach, when I was younger and half as smart. And with that, I'll end the presentation, and we can have some questions and enjoy the veteran. No questions?
Never.
Okay.
100%. Tonight we have one veteran of the Normandy campaign. He's not British and he's not Canadian. He's a Minnesotan, moved to Fargo and then back to Minnesota, so he got around a little bit. He was also not an infantryman, he was an airman. But one of the things that John decided not to talk about when he heard who our veteran was going to be was the significance of the air campaign. The Germans had virtually no air force in Normandy, and we had an air force that was unparalleled in all of human history. And its mission was first to prepare the battlefield, and then secondly, to disrupt all German communications and troop movements within the area. And they were immensely successful at that. Most of these German divisions that you saw here were seriously degraded by the time they got to Normandy. It was Rommel's plan to have the German divisions up front so they could immediately counterattack in force. And Hitler wanted them held back. Eventually there was a compromise. Rommel got a few units. But all the German units that moved forward were decimated as they moved forward. And by the time they got to Normandy, in many cases, they were half strength. And once they got there, they fought with what they had. It was virtually impossible for them to reinforce and replace the tanks that they lost and the troops that they lost. And so that was the role of the Air Force in the campaign. And we have with us a man tonight who participated very significantly in that campaign. Dick Brown was a B-26 pilot in the 394th Bomb Group of the 584th Bomb Squadron. Like I said, he was born in Minneapolis in 1922, moved to Fargo where he was raised, and worked for Northwest Airlines before the war. He was appointed as an aviation cadet in April of 1942 and was called to training in August of 1942. He received his wings in May of 1943. And did you get the assignment that you wanted when you got out of school?
When I got my wings in 43, they wanted me to stay on and be an instructor at the Army base. So I went to school to be an instructor, but I'd been there about a week, and they came in and said, well, we have a lieutenant here that's married, and we're going to keep him and send you off to combat. I said, well, okay. So I wanted to always go into a twin-engine bomber. I didn't want to have a fighter, or I didn't want to go to a four-engine. So when they kicked me out of the school, I was given, handed the plaque, said, go fly the B-17, the four-engine bomber, over in Tucson. So I didn't want to do that, but I found a friend that was waiting to leave that had a program to go to B-26s down in the four-engine was in Tucson. I was just to go to MacDill Field in Tampa, Florida. So I traded with him, and I got that assignment. I went down to Tampa, Florida, started my training as a co-pilot on the B-26 medium bomber, and we moved through the to a couple of fields, and we're up in Battle Creek, Michigan. The B-26 bomber did a good job over in the South Pacific. They used it for strafing. We could carry a load of 4,000 pounds of bombs. We also had 11 guns on the airplane. So they used it over there against the Japanese at low level, at high level. It didn't matter there. Well, we had a little problem. The Air Force said over in Britain in 1943 with the medium bomber. They tried to use it at low level. In one of their first missions, 10 of the B-26s went over to bomb the E-boat pens in Amoyden, Holland. They went out at 300 feet, which was an area that they used a lot because they did a lot of strafing and they could fly at that altitude. They went over there, 10 of them, and they all got shot down because the German Air Force got a hold of them. Also, the E-boat pens had a lot of anti-aircraft. So then they didn't know what to do with them. They were a little hesitant about the twin engine. So back in the States, we were moved to two or three different stations while they're trying to figure out what we're going to do. Well, and October of 1943, they decided to activate the bombers and use them at higher level. So I was then put in the position as the first pilot on the B-26, and we got our crews together and left for England in February of 44. We had to go because it was the winter time, and our twin-engine bomber didn't have a big fuel load. We had about 5 hours of fuel on, and that wasn't enough in the winter up on the northern North Atlantic at the airfields because they had a lot of bad weather up there. So we left and had to go down through South America, made 4 stops on the way down there to Natal, went out to the Ascension Islands, up the east coast of Africa, and then on to England. We left on the 7th of February and didn't get over to England until the 22nd.
How many miles was that?
10,000 miles. But we had to, because of the weather in South America during the winter and our small fuel load, we'd get up and probably fly for 4 hours in the morning. We'd try to land by noon because that's when they'd have the bad weather. So it took us a long time to get there. And on the last part of the trip from Marrakesh, North Africa, we had to go out over the Atlantic. And because the Germans were still in charge of everything along there, and fortunately, we were able to go out far enough to see where the Germans didn't bother to come out after us, or they didn't pick us up on radar. Then we landed in England, and southwest coast of England. We just barely made it with our fuel load. We stayed the night there and then moved up to an airport northeast of London at Boreham. And that's where we then got there in February. But I didn't fly my first mission until I think it was March 31st. And because we had to train up there, formation flying, and also we were going to be used from the altitude of 8 to 12,000 feet. And we had to practice our formations, which the way we bombed in the medium bombers, we had six ships, right? Three up here and three down below. And that would be the formation, and we'd do our bombing in that situation. So we had to practice a lot before they sent us on our first mission. One of my first missions was back to Amoyden, Holland, where they'd been shot down over there. And we went in at 12,000 feet, dropped our bombs, but the E-boat pens that we were trying to penetrate had about 30 to 40 feet of concrete, and it didn't bother them a bit. But we didn't have any trouble at that altitude. So that was the start of my career over there.
How often did you go up and fly? How often did you fly a mission? Ultimately, you had 65 missions, 66.
66, ultimately. And it was a matter, you just got put in the pool, and they would decide, just go down the list and not make you work every day. But I was there from, my first mission was in March, and my last mission was in September. Mm-hmm. And during that time, I flew 66 missions.
Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of the missions you went after were bridges, communication facilities, well, those sorts of things, roads, trains?
Because of our bomb load, or fuel load, we couldn't penetrate to Germany.
No, but in France.
Yeah, we did all of our, I only had one mission to Germany. Out of the 66 that I flew, most of my bombing was done in Belgium, Holland, mainly in France. And our objective was to bomb all the bridges on the rivers leading into Paris that you saw in here. We were bombing bridges on those to keep the Germans from, they were, I think at the time, trying to isolate Normandy. And so we'd keep those, we'd bomb. And I'm afraid that at times we got into the middle of some of the cities, and I'm sure that we killed a number of French people. We were never proud of it because sometimes our bombs would drop not on the target, but they'd be in the city someplace. But we tried to keep it to where we go to airfields, we bomb the airfields over there, bomb anything that the Air Force could find or were told that they needed, there was targets that we had to bomb. So it went on like that the whole time. And we finally, my 33rd mission was D-Day. And of course, I can wake up a lot of times thinking about that day, because it was at midnight, the night before, we were awakened by noise. The weather was bad, had a very low ceiling, and we could hear airplanes in the air. We hadn't been told it was D-Day. They didn't let anybody know that. And we went outside and looked up, and I could see the C-47s towing gliders, and they were heading south, and I knew that must be the day. Well, at the same time, at midnight in D-Day, they used 2 million gallons of white paint and painted 10,000 airplanes with the stripes around the wings. You've probably seen the pictures. the stripes went around both wings and around the fuselage. And the reason being, they didn't know what altitudes or anything we were going to drop our bombs. Or once we got on the air on D-Day, if they told any gunners or anybody, if they don't have stripes, shoot them. So we got over, we took off on D-Day. It was raining, a low ceiling. We formed underneath it in our squadrons and things and climbed up through the clouds. And we lost a couple airplanes in the clouds that day, but as we higher we got, the more daylight. It was getting 5 o'clock in the morning then. And so we got up on top at 11,000 feet, reformed our crews together, went over the channel, found a hole in the, over the English Channel, and a hole in the clouds, so we spiraled down through, and we ended up at 1,500 feet. We bombed Utah Beach, and fortunately, because we could see our targets, we hit the gun emplacements that were needed at Utah. And so mainly the people that were hurt on Utah Beach drowned when they got out of the boats. When we got under the clouds before we dropped our bombs, the channel was just full of boats. And that's why they had told the gunners on the ships down there that if they don't have stripes, shoot them. Because if we were going pretty fast, and they wouldn't be able to recognize what kind of an airplane was going over them. And one German fighter came through there, and he had a P-47 American fighter on his tail and shot him down. That's the only fighter we saw that day. But we get near our targets, and they gave us a little welcome over there. But we only lost one airplane out of our 54 airplanes that day that we put up. We lost one of them over the target. And then we made our way back to England. And as I looked down, we could not drop our bombs going into the beach. We could not drop our bombs later than 6:25. And because we had to waste so much time coming down through the clouds and everything, we dropped ours at 6:24. Well, I looked out the window, and here's all those boats, and the guys are in the landing barges going in there. They're just less than a quarter mile offshore, and I thought, oh boy, you're going to be digging foxholes in the sand, and I'll be home having a second breakfast if I make it through the flak. And that was, and we did. I got back there, right, but we had. Did you want to?
No, I was going to say, because of the nature of your missions, you didn't have encounters with German aircraft very often. You want to talk about that a little bit, and then talk about the flak that you encountered in some of your close calls.
Yes, because of our short range, we could only go out about 2.5 hours. If we had a full 4,000 pounds of bomb to carry out there. And so we'd take off, get in our formation, and go out over the English Channel, and there'd be American or British fighters waiting for us out there. We didn't care who they were, as long as they're some of our fighters. They would follow us into the target. We'd have cover above and below until we got to the target. And sometimes we'd see German airplanes out there, but they didn't dare come in because we had so much protection. And plus the fact, over in the South Pacific and down in the North Africa, we had 11 guns on our airplane that could be fired at fighters if they came near us. So they didn't like to come. I've talked to German Luftwaffe pilots out at the Flying Cloud Airport when they've had the services out there and have a lot of things going. I've talked to some of those pilots, and they said, no, they didn't like to come near the B-26s because we flew a close formation, and we had an awful lot of guns pointed at people.
Well, you're talking about formations, and you mentioned it, but you told me earlier just how close you were flying to other airplanes.
Well,
talk about that a little bit.
The Well, it depended on a lot of times the wing of the airplane that I was flying on would probably be 20 feet away. And we'd be, because we wanted to have close formation. And so when we dropped our bombs, they'd hit the target. And so we had, there were times that it was pretty close and we had to be careful.
Sometimes if the weather was bad, you got to 10 feet.
Yes, there was when we had to climb up through the clouds, I was fortunate enough to be on the right wing of that airplane, I could see the green light. And the left wing had a red light. And if I could be out here, because I'm the captain on the airplane, I don't hit it. That's all that mattered. And I could, we had some pretty close calls that way, but we had to do it in order to keep our formations. But we did the formations over there. What would do, the lead airplane of the six had a bomb sight, and the number four position had one. I flew on the, I only led twice when I was over there, but I'd fly on the wing, so when the lead airplane with the bomb sight would open his bomb bay doors, ours would open his. As soon as he saw the first bomb drop, he'd drop ours. So we had what was called pattern bombing. He would aim a little bit short of the target, and then the rest of us would just cover the whole thing and go beyond it. So it's in cases like that. Of course, it was St. Lo that after D-Day, and the troops are there, we were bombing in front of our troops most of the time, trying to keep the Germans back. And over St. Lo there, the first day, we came in and we're up at about 10,000 feet. And the trajectory, when you drop it from that altitude, this goes out quite a ways. And so a lot of times we could be over our own troops when they drop the bombs and they'd go beyond our troops. Well, the one day in St. Lo, our lead airplane opened his bomb bay doors and had an accidental bomb drop. Usually they'd open the bomb bay doors and we'd open ours, wait for the first bomb. On that particular day, when he opened his bomb bay doors, a bomb had shaken loose in there and dropped. Immediately the rest of us dropped ours. Well, now we aren't to the target yet. So they killed 150 Americans with our bombs. The next day, friendly fire knocked down three of ours, of our bombers. And then the generals got together and decided, let's not do any more of that.
Okay. Talk about some of your close encounters with German flak.
Well, that was our worst problem. We didn't have to worry about the fighters because we had cover. The minute the flak started, 88 millimeter, 75, 88 millimeter flak. It'd just be a big puff out here. And when I saw the flame of it bursting, I know I was going to get hit by shrapnel. If it was out far enough away where I couldn't see the explosion, I didn't worry too much. But those Germans, it only took them 15 seconds from the time they spotted us, decided what altitude, they had good radar, they could set things up. It only took 15 seconds for the shell to get up there, or no, 20 seconds for that. So what we used to do, we'd use evasive action. We'd turn every 15 seconds when we got near the targets or where we knew there was flak positions. And then we turned back, maybe turned twice, because it took them 20 seconds to get to us. Well, there'd be bombs, flak all over the place. But we missed a few targets, so our commanding officer said, from now on, you're going to have a 1 minute shot at the targets. Well, then we started losing airplanes. I had the nose blown off twice, plexiglass nose off the airplane. The shells came up and took it off. And of course,
talk about your bombardier in the nose.
Well, yeah, we. Of course. didn't tell you, there were six people on my airplane. I had the bombardier up front, the co-pilot, the pilot, the top gunner, the waist gunner, and a tail gunner. So there's six. And the bombardier, of course, was up in the nose where the he couldn't have a bomb sight if we needed it. Well, and he also had a gun up there, one of his guns. So the first time the nose got blown off, he had just pulled his head back. He'd been looking down at the target, and he just pulled his head back like that when the whole nose, plexiglass nose, came off the airplane. He got one little piece up his nose, and that was all. And of course, at the time when that happened, it's a big hole like this, and I had to pull out of the formation. I had to slow up and keep control of the airplane, and so I pulled out, and then two fighters would come down and be sure that I got home. They'd follow me home to be sure I got there. And that happened to me twice. And there were times that I'd bring the airplane home and it would have at least 100 holes in it. But we were fortunate in that B-26 Martin Marauder that it could really take a beating. My gosh, it would just... I had part of a wing blown off one day, the tip out there, part of that blown off. But I could drive it home, but we'd have 100 holes in it, and then they'd have to take a day off and fix the holes before we'd send it out again. But they could patch them up. And one day, we had a flak suit that I'd wear here. I was the pilot, fortunately. I had a little armor around me, too. They made sure that I didn't get hit from every angle. But it had an apron, and I decided the flak goes up. So I used to take my apron off and sit on it. Figured that'd be just one more piece of protection. Well, one day, when we were in there getting hit, I got raised out of my seat a little bit, and I got home all right and everything, but then in there I found a piece of flak about that big that had come up through the armor plating. But fortunately, because I was sitting on part of my flak suit, that stopped the rest of it. So I'd have been talking in a high voice. but that was the main thing. The flak was our big problem. I had friends of mine blown up right beside me, and just all of a sudden, they get hit in the middle of the airplane, they get hit in the middle, and just be blown out of the sky. And you had to watch out for. And it happened one time when I was flying number four position. We're going along, and the number two man up here got blown out of the sky, and so I dropped back, and the two guys with me followed me. We came back. And then the lead airplane didn't know that I had fallen back. So those two guys dropped their bombs. But I didn't dare release mine because we're way behind him and he's got the bomb sight. So we just held our bombs and dropped them over the channel on the way home, dropped them in the channel.
Okay, we're going to go to questions a little bit, but Dick was... separated before the end of the war. He came home, he put in his time, went back to work for Northwest Airlines, married a stewardess, and worked for Northwest for 36 years?
36 years,
very successful career as a pilot, and then as an instructor, I think, did you say?
Yes, I ended up being a supervisor on three of the different jets, the 707, the 720, and the DC-10. I happened to be in charge of the training pilots on those airplanes. So I ended up with 24,000 hours of flying for my career. But on one thing, when I came back, I married a stewardess, but it happens that I had known her. She was from Fargo also. We had grown up together, and she was only a year behind me in school, so it wasn't any... thing I just picked up. It was we'd known each other all our life.
Any questions tonight?
How did it happen that the Polish battalion got ahead of you guys to Falaise?
The 1st Polish Armored Division was under our command. 2nd Canadian Corps attached for total eyes and tractable. And they were assigned on the left flank. And it was part of the plan for them to actually be the spearhead at that moment in time. So it was part of the plan, actually, for them to actually lead. So that's why they... That's why they got there.
That was from a Polish guy.
Question for John. Once the Allies reached Paris, how long did it take them to get control of the city and the area?
Well, there was some political considerations about Paris and about who was going to enter Paris. The Germans don't defend Paris, as you're aware. They don't turn it into a Stalingrad or anything like that. And thankfully for us, the French are allowed to enter Paris as the first in. I think elements of Third Army tried to sneak in. This is part of Patton's modus operandi to beat everybody everywhere every time. it didn't take that long. The First Army rolls, Third Army rolls past Paris pretty quick.
Dick has one more comment he wants to make.
I want to make one more comment. When I came back from overseas, well, I'll talk about over in England, the Tuskegee Airmen, the blacks, finally came over there. They were in their own squadron, and there wasn't a B-17 shot down after the Tuskegee Airmen got the long-range fighters over there. Anyone that they went in escort of, they never lost an airplane to German fighters. And also, now when I came home, I went down to Harlingen, Texas, to tow targets over the Gulf. And there were 7 WASPs, the Women Air Service pilots, down there. And they were some of the best pilots I've ever known. They could go to any factory and pick up an airplane and deliver it to an airfield. I could only fly one airplane at that time. Then I got with Northwest in 45. They wouldn't allow a black or a woman to be a pilot at that time. We didn't hire one until we hired the first black about 1965 and the first woman pilot about 1972 or 3. But it was just too bad. They were just totally ignored.
Question for John. Early in your talk, you mentioned that the Allies would take advantage of the predictable German counteroffense. Could you explain that, please?
The fundamental basis of German defensive doctrine was an immediate counterattack. So once they had absorbed a blow or lost their main line of defense, it was virtually automatic that they would commit reserves to immediately retake that ground. They lightly defended their very forward areas, but their main defensive positions were counterattacked vigorously because they simply didn't want to surrender that ground in the the work that they had done preparing it. And we learned gradually that at that moment when they counterattacked was the moment when we could bring down massive artillery and actually break up those attacks and sometimes even destroy them in their assembly areas because they just templated themselves. They did it so often that it became very, very predictable. And I think, I haven't worked out the math, but I would dare say that we killed more Germans when they counterattacked than while we attacked them originally.
On flying in formation. How do pilots, I know nothing about this, how do pilots fly in formation and keep from running into each other being that close together?
You just pay attention to what you're doing is what it amounts to.
Yeah.
Well, we worked at it all the time. Had to do it.
I had the opportunity to be in Normandy last May, and I was in Bayeux. We stayed there for a couple of days, and there's a large British cemetery in Bayeux or Bayeux. And I noticed that there were a number of Russian graves there. Who were the Russians? Which were they attached to some British or Canadian units?
No, the it's possible that the some Russian nationals served with the British forces, but the bulk of the Russian graves in Normandy are Russians serving with the German units. Allied intelligence estimated right before D-Day that about 30% of all German infantry in Normandy were Russian POWs. All those static divisions along the coast, the ones that we come ashore against, 352nd, 711, 716, have significant bodies, entire foreign battalions of Russian POWs. And that was standard throughout the German army in the West. You have to realize how many millions of men the Germans have lost, killed, missing, and wounded before we ever come ashore. They are dragging the bottom of the barrel.
John, what was the attitude of the Canadian people? Because the Canadians took an inordinate amount of losses relative to its population versus the Brits. How did the Canadians take that?
Population at the time, there's no evidence that it was a concern. Some historians have made an issue of it after the fact, suggesting that the British purposely used us as a battering ram or gave us the most difficult assignments to save British casualties. But I don't buy that. The British take their fair share. We're all volunteers.
Hey, John, just a follow-up question on that. As far as the selection of Canadian commanders and the command and control apparatus, who actually selected the general in command of the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division? You mentioned that he was weak and he was not a combat veteran. So how did that process work? What were the politics?
The process for us was very simple. The Canadian Army trains in England for essentially 4 years, and two divisions go off to Italy, but Montgomery has a huge influence on the selection of commanders because he has the combat experience, and he's listened to. In many ways, he's the father of the Canadian Army. Our senior commanders have no combat experience. Andy McNaughton has none in the war. Carrera has none in the war. Guy Simmons has none in the war at that point. So Montgomery is listened to, and he recommends the relief of multiple Canadian commanders. And some have interpreted that as anti-Canadian bias, but he and the Chief of the Imperial General Staff, General Brooke, decimate the command structure of the British Army after the defeat in France in 1940. So they're just as ruthless on their own people as they are on us. And essentially, they're looking for the best possible people. Kurar highly recommends Keller to be the commander of the division. Unfortunately, Keller has a history. He's a staff officer who's given command of a fighting formation. There's no question that he had a drinking problem. Before D-Day, his brigadiers try to oust him up the chain of command, suggesting that he's not fit. It's just one of those cases where we didn't have anybody ready. The only people we had ready were still in Italy, and they were fighting with the 8th Army. So after all this talk and frustration with gaining battle experience, we come ashore in Normandy completely raw from top to bottom.
Building on Mark's question, if you would have had better commanders, I think it'd have been more favorable results?
I think so. I think Keller loses control of the division and doesn't fight the division as a full division. He fights it as individual brigades. And we see that actually a lot in many commanders who get fixated on fighting this regiment at that time or that brigade rather than leveraging all the combat power of the division to achieve an objective. And our learning curve in Normandy has to be incredibly steep. that Keller survives as long as he does is, well, Guy Simmons says he's not willing to pull the trigger on him simply because of morale. He doesn't want the morale of the division to suffer by getting rid of the commander. But that's a double-edged sword. That's a value judgment. That's the burden of command.
But it's important to remember, too, that it wasn't just the Canadians. Americans had incompetent, inexperienced division commanders. The German commander of the 21st Panzer Division was a party functionary, had no combat experience or no combat experience that would have recommended him for a division command. The day the invasion happened, he was in a whorehouse in Paris. So, you know, I mean, it happens. It wasn't something unique to the Canadians to have inexperienced commanders.
Did the how many French troops were in the area, Free French, and I understand, or I think that maybe the Leclerc was in the Falaise area, and did he hold back?
General Leclerc is 2nd French Armored Division. He's part of U.S. 15 Corps, which transfers from the west coast and essentially leads the breakout at various points. Leclerc is actually in the vanguard of 15 Corps at various stages. The Free French are fully active. The estimates are around 30,000 Free French troops in the in France, which is there are different terms. There's the Maquis, and then there's the Free French of the Interior, and there are other French resistance groups. That 30,000 is for the active resistance operators who are physically going out and sabotaging, interdicting German supply lines, communications, carrying out assassinating commanders, snipers, whoever they can engage. But it's a poorly understood part of the story, but I think they had a significant impact on delaying some German units as they make their way up to the front. I'm sure they do significant damage to 2nd SS Panzer Division as it makes its way up from the south of France.
Question here?
Yeah. How many Germans and Russians and so on are here tonight?
How many Germans and Russians are here? I don't know. Raise your hand, anybody, Russian or German? I know there's a Polish guy that asked a question earlier.
I'll answer it. When Hitler struck Russia, 3 million Russians surrendered and wanted to fight with the Germans against Stalin. But the Germans started killing them off, and the thing turned around. So some of these are volunteers initially and stayed, I suppose, that's my knowledge.
Are there any studies during the war or post-war about estimating the number of French civilians who were casualties of Allied bombing?
There are, absolutely, and his name escapes me at the moment, but a historian down at the Center for Military History has done the most recent work on that. And he was actually in Canada talking about that, the number of French civilians we killed. I think the estimate was 100,000 total from air, from artillery bombardment, from everything. I mean, the French are... We dropped leaflets. We tried to do our best to indicate, within reason, in support of operational security, that something's going to happen. But some people just don't leave their villages. They don't leave their homes, and we're blowing up a village because the Germans are there. It's a nasty part of the equation. But it was I'm not sure how we would do it otherwise.
Yeah, you mentioned that. That Canadian forces were all volunteers. Did the Canadian forces all through World War II consist entirely of volunteers, no conscription?
We don't have conscription until the very, very end, when the Mackenzie King government, because we have such serious manpower shortages, he invokes conscription, and we send about 16,000 soldiers overseas. Conscripts. But for the bulk, for the most part, we're all volunteers until the very end. And we just, it's a small army. The Canadian Army, we probably should not have had an Army headquarters. It consumed a lot of resources. We had two corps, three infantry divisions, two armored divisions, and two separate armored brigades. So we have a small army, but we probably should have had a very powerful corps just for manpower savings alone. And then we split between Northwest Europe and Italy with two lines of communication that caused problems too. A lot of wastage.
Okay, that's going to be it for tonight. So thank you very much for coming, and come again.
Support for this program provided by viewers like you. Thank you. Additional support provided through the Catherine B. Anderson Fund of the St. Paul Foundation. Upcoming roundtable topics can be found at www.mn-ww2roundtable.org. Production services provided by Barrows Productions.